the Madman.
Core set 2022.
Oh, the cards that are in it are finally out, and it's actually more exciting than expected. I wasn't necessarily expecting much because the core set 2021, while strong and very innovative and very good for free to play, in that gave new players a bunch of legendaries, bunch of epics, rares, all sorts of useful cards, enough to make some of the strongest, like, out-of-the-gate free-to-play decks you could ever do. The cards, you saw them here and there in decks, but they're, like, they were a minor part of the decks. Just, like, a card here, a card there, never really part of the main strategy, I would say. They're just the support cards and are often overshadowed by the expansion cards, especially since the expansions get more and more powerful. On reading Core Set 2022, that kind of same mentality hit me, with the twist that there's a few cards out there which may be strong enough and like deck-defining enough that they are still impactful, and also some of the cards are getting buffed. If a card is getting buffed in the core set, then that actually might mean it's still good enough. Demon Hunter is getting Metamorphosis, Wrathscale Naga, Flame Reaper, and Wrathscale Naga and Feast of Souls are getting buffed. So Metamorphosis was already in standard because it's an outland card. This probably won't have any impact because it already doesn't have impact in the current Fel spell with Jace. So it's probably still too slow. Wrathscale Naga, cool little combo card. It's getting a buff from 1 to 2 health, but that probably is completely non-impactful. Unless tokens get way better. Tokens might be getting way better because Feast of Souls costs 1 mana instead of 2. This was a spell that actually was conceivably a decent spell back then for the token decks at 2. So now at 1, I actually think this is a real push for a token Demon Hunter deck. The Feast of Souls at 1 mana, that's a big deal. Flame Reaper is just way too slow. Whatever. Druid's getting 6 cards. Fandral Staghelm, an old popular legendary. Choose 1 cards, have both effects. Feel like this might be too slow, even though it was pretty good back in the day. Ancient of Lore got nerfed to draw 1 card a little bit ago. Reversion back to draw 2 cards, but still too slow probably right now. Earthen Scales, this is one of the cards that I actually might see play because you can get the minions like really insane these days, especially with Guff. 1 mana gain a lot of armor could be good enough. This is apparently good enough in Wild, so this is one of those cards that kind of scales with power creep because the minions get better, which makes Earthen Scales get better because it gives more armor. Living Roots is a card that saw some pretty popular amount of play, still might see play because token druids might want to have 1 mana 7-2-1 ones. It would be on the lower side of the power these days, but maybe still decent. Good old Wrath is back. It was like on the way out in the last year's core set not entirely sure if we want to play this in our deck. I think decks have gotten stronger, so Wrath's still probably not going to see play, but has a small chance at it. Mountain Raptor, cute, but not good enough these days. Nourish, huge buff. Nourish now costs 5 mana, down from 6. That is a big buff. So yeah, that's a big deal. Hunter's getting a few like generally good cards. You got Handmaster Shaw, Candle Shot, Spring Paw, Cloaked Huntress, Marked Shot, and Animal Companion. That's kind of what the core set is. Generally good cards. Really good to start off with these strong sets of cards, but these are all older cards, and the older cards have just gotten overshadowed by the newer cards. They're good. And I wouldn't even be surprised if some of them saw some amount of play, but they're gonna be like the last cards, I think, that you would think about putting into a deck. Which is to say, like, you might be surprised at a card like Animal Companion that I'm saying that to, but like Animal Companion, it's barely good enough to put in a deck, I think. And I could easily see it getting cut. Don't fall in love with these cards, in other words. Like, they're good options, but I doubt that they're going to be the strongest option. For Mage, you got Caligos, Pyroblast, Explosive Ruins, Pyromaniac, and Blizzard coming in. Caligos is getting a buff, 9 mana instead of 10, and there's actually a deck that Caligos goes right into, Big Spell Mage. So the thing about Caligos being 9 mana is Clumsy Courier costs 7 mana and is often not played in these decks, and the purpose would be to speed out your big spells. So if Clumsy Courier isn't being played, Caligos might not be at 9. Even though he could be used multiple times, it's just perhaps unnecessary, but perhaps good enough. Paladins got some cool cards rotating in. You got Ragnar's Light Lord, Flash of Light, Bronze Explorer, and Amber Watcher. These are all premium health restoration cards, good for a control paladin base. Furthermore, control paladin getting a boost with Equality coming back and costing 2 mana. Bronze Explorer also increasing attack value to 3 attacks, so now a 3-3 with Lifesteal and Discover a Dragon. These are all cards that are actually quite good for value or control paladins. Perhaps that's a deck. A control-ish paladin. A lot of healing, strong against aggro, Carryall gains value over time. I could see it. Priest! Now, Priest is the class that is getting, like, basically Hall of Fame. Everything that was really good is now getting put back in the Priest. You got Lyra, Murizan, Light Bomb, Drachnid Operative, Northshire Cleric, and Radiant Elemental. Radiant Elemental, probably the most surprising one, because Sorcerer's Apprentice was found to be so problematic that she had to disappear. A little bit of everything for players here. There's the APM Priest style of play, there's the Dragon style of play, there's the Control style of play, and then there's going full Northshire Cleric, as always. With these cards all being quite strong, it's conceivable, and I want to try it out, that maybe you put in most of these cards in some sort of small dragon package and run Reno Jackson with Quest Priest. Seems like that could be a good value control, like, benchmark deck to beat. Over in Rogue, we got Tess Greymane, Buccaneer, and HenchClan Burglar coming in. I could see the Buccaneer and HenchClan Burglar being particularly relevant because of the pirate theme of the new set. Buccaneer preps for the more tempo-oriented, HenchClan Burglar for the more value-oriented. Both are reasonable options. Tess Greymane is way too slow to ever be useful, but she's a fan favorite. Shaman is getting Cragwall the Frog, Farsight, Maelstrom Portal, Flametongue Totem, and Bloodlust. Flametongue Totem and Bloodlust will support a more board-focused Shaman style, full of tokens, potentially. As there are no readily apparent ways to get tokens in Shaman, or like have big cards early on that would benefit from Flametongue Totem, I actually think that most of these cards will not be very relevant. Grag was here though, if you feel like you need even more value in your mid-range Naga spell shaman. Warlock gets basically a bunch of junk. You got High Priestess Jeklik, Darkshire Librarian, Imp Gang Boss, Abyssal Enforcer, and Voidwalker. Jeklik getting buffed from a 3-4 to a 3-5. There's no synergy for discard yet, but maybe someday this Jeklik deck might actually be scary. Voidwalker and Imp Gang Boss, they were pretty good 6 years ago, but they have lost their relevance. And Abyssal Enforcer didn't actually make the cut 6 years ago, so it's not going to make the cut today. Warrior is getting Darius Crowley, Bash, Bloodhoof Brave, and Shield Block, with Darius Crowley getting buffed up to a 5-mana 4-5 rush. Execute getting buffed to cost 1 mana. Now that Execute buff, that's pretty strong. That could see play for sure. Shield Block's back, that might be good enough to see play in Control Warrior, not sure yet. It was a mainstay for a very long time. It's just a good card to pass your time if you have nothing better to do, as Control Warrior often doesn't have anything to do. So, yeah, could see that one. Bash, too slow, too irrelevant. Bloodhoof Brave, too irrelevant. Darius Crowley, even with one more health, it's like, wow, 5-mana, 4-5 rush, huh? That's when the rush mechanic first came out. Cards have gotten a lot better now. We'll leave the League of Explorers last for the analysis for the neutrals. Let's go from the commons up. Overall theme, there's actually a decent amount of neutral dragons here supporting a dragon-based strategy. Perhaps that's going to come up later. Currently, there doesn't seem to be very much that's focused on dragons, other than Drachnid Operative from Priest. So it's not nice that they're getting this support. Cobalt Scalebane, a little too slow these days, but was a pretty good mid-range dragon back in the day. Gorillabot A3. Normally this wouldn't be exciting at all, but this is getting buffed to a 3-mana 3-4. That is a huge deal. It is a 3-mana 3-4. That's a mech, which discovers another mech if you control a mech. Very relevant for the mech mage and mech paladin out there. I got Tar Creeper coming in. Tar Creeper was pretty good. Was like one of those cards you put in every deck just to defend against aggro way back in the day. Maybe you see Tar Creeper as a one of in your Reno deck. Acolyte of Pain. Now this is a very popular card draw engine. Card drawing allows you to draw your stronger cards these days, and the card draw hasn't necessarily gotten that much stronger. So Acolyte of Pain, like that, this could be a really big deal. Especially if you're a class that has ways to deal damage in small ways to your minions. Played Beetle, a little bit too weak nowadays. 2-mana, 2-3 beast, game 3 armor, whatever. Injured Tolvir, that's never been relevant, but hey, it's here now. Cool. Fairy Dragon, that's another small dragon option if you wanted to play a dragon deck. Mistress of Mixtures, this is a very useful anti-aggro tool. I could see a lot of decks which want to survive into the mid-late game with playing their Colossals or big end-game finishers. Slide the Mistress of Mixtures as an early-game card. Beaming Sidekick, nice little aggro card, tempo card. Has not gotten power crept yet because it's still pretty recent. Azure Drake, 5-mana, 4-5. Spell damage plus 1, Battlecry, draw a card. This famous card that was once too strong and had to get rotated out of the core set, is back with a buff. So that's how much stronger the cards have gotten over the past. This is a card that probably is only relevant because Draconid Operative is also back, and Draconid Operative might make it so that you need more dragons, and then if you need to look for dragons, you know, maybe you add in this weak little 5-mana 4-5 dragon with spell damage plus 1, which draws a card. Twilight Drake, you got your 4-mana hand locky type thing. Still good, I'd say, in decks that have big hands. Life Drinker was a card that was actually played in mid-range or face type decks. Tempo decks, really. I think these days a little too slow, a little too weak in stats to stand up to the other cards. Wild Pyromancer, Equality has a new partner now. Maybe you run City Tax instead. But Wild Pyromancer could still be good with a Maki Roll card from Paladin. And there's Acolyte of Pain, so Wild Pyromancer is a classic that could be good. It scales with good spells, and there are many better spells. Sea Giant, still good because you drop this in decks which create a bunch of small guys and you cheat out like a 4-mana 8-8 or a 3-mana 8-8. Might be a little too slow these days. Not enough of a payout. Primordial Drake, only thing I can think of for use for this card would be the one of the 8 drops in a Dragon Quest Priest. That's a really specific statement. This card has basically gotten really power crept over the years. Mossy Hara, 6-mana 2-7, Battlecry destroy all of their minions with 2 or less attack. It was a tech card way back. I can't imagine what use this card has for tech these days, but it's safe to say that if there are a bunch of 2 or less attack cards in the meta, that you would consider running Mossy Horror, I suppose. Escaped Mana Saber was good, still could be good. Volpera Scoundrel, this is one of those cards that I used to be really excited over. I was like, oh man, they're really pushing the limits of these 3-mana cards that, you know, get you a card. These days, I think the 3-mana cards which get you a card are even on the level of 3-3s or 2-4s. So the Scoundrel might not see play. The only way I could see this one seeing play is if Reno decks really needed a 30th card. Murloc Warleader. Nice little Murloc. Murloc Warlock is, of course, a deck that looks like it's on the up and up, so Murloc Warleader seems like it could be a deck, which could be a card that's good in that deck. I only say could be because that's not great stats for the cost, and also I'm not entirely sure if Murloc Warlock is a swarm the board type of deck. It might be. I'm not like certain that this card actually makes the cut. And good old Doomsayer's back. This card could definitely stand the test of time. Still really good with freeze. and Free Shaman exists. Blizzard is back for Mage, so Blizzard Doomsayer could be a big stall. Because Doomsayer always relied on the supporting cards that went with it, the support cards are there, so Doomsayer really could be here. Zola the Gorgon, that's a decent card, also a Naga. Youthful Brewmaster is also in, so not entirely sure that you actually need Zola, but is an option. Alright, and then on to the Explorers. Free-to-play experience probably never has been better with this many legendaries in the core set, completely free to everyone. We'll start with the weakest Explorer, I guess, Elise Starseeker. This is a card that really has gotten power crept with like better Elise versions and better cards that put you on mini quests. Elise Starseeker, sorry, you're kind of getting bullied. Sir Finley Murgleton, Murloc, that's kind of cool. Not entirely sure if you want to play this card to discover a new hero power, but that's pretty reasonable. Could see a lot of, you know, tempo aggro decks still trying to play this in order to get the Hunter hero power or the Warlock hero power. Neat option to have. Bran Bronzebeard. This possibly should have been saved for the most impactful Explorer, but I have my pet favorite. Everyone has their pet favorite coming up. Bran Bronzebeard is a card that doesn't necessarily get power crept because battle cries have gotten stronger, which means if you're triggering the battle cries that are powerful twice, then Bran Bronzebeard is getting pulled up to that level of battle cry, of which some are quite insane. So Bran Bronzebeard, a number of really good battle cries out there right now, a number of good battle cries in the future, something to watch out for. And finally, the big one! Reno Jackson, obviously a 6-mana 4-6 Battlecry fully heal your hero is insane, so this is one card that doesn't get power crept. The downside is you have to have, you know, a deck that's a pile of cards with probably no apparent synergy and no combos, and decks have gotten more refined and you might need that kind of consistency, but at the same time, there are decks out there in the meta which only have like 10 cards that are doubled up. And those aren't like super essential cards. One of the big examples is Quest Priest, actually. Quest Priest could be the most obvious deck for Reno Jackson, but there could be a few others as well. You can easily have Reno Jackson and 29 other good cards. So I think this will probably be one of the best cards for a free-to-play player starting out the game. When you're starting out your account and you aren't going to have like many duplicates anyway, so Reno Jackson is just super good for that reason as well. Reno Jackson decks always have like a lot of variability to them because there's a lot of debate between what the 20th to 30th worst card in decks are and what you might want to replace those with. Reno Jackson is like one of the most creative type of cards where you can express your deck building philosophy. So yeah, cool stuff. Core set is going to do what it's meant to do. It's going to be the glue behind your deck. If you need some tools, the core set's there for you. For the most part, it's going to be weaker than the cards from the expansions, but it's got some spice in it this time around. So onwards, we're gonna be rich.